Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about theorem proving, in particular automated theorem proving, and the techniques of resolution, and I'll shortly say something about unification. So let's get started. So first of all, this wall of text. It's from a paper by Davies and Putnam from 1960, in which they write that Hilbert, the same Hilbert that I talked about in the last video, noting that all of classical mathematics could be formalized within quantification theory, first order logic, declared that the problem of finding an algorithm for determining whether or not a given formula of quantification theory is valid was the central problem of mathematical logic. So he declared that you want to be able to decide whether a formula is valid or not. And now, over time, it turns out that Church and Turing showed that such a decision procedure cannot exist. And this has resulted in a considerable pessimism. Some people said that Hilbert's program failed. Mathematics cannot be done by computers. Okay, that might be true. But more recently, so from the 1960s onwards, there has been a revival of interest in this whole question. Specifically, it has been realized that while no decision procedure exists, there are many proof procedures available. And this is also what we have seen previously. This set of, this sound and complete set of valid formulas is recognizable, although it is not decidable. So that means that uniform procedures, which will ultimately locate a proof for any formula of first order logic, which is valid, but it will run forever in the case of a formula that is not valid. And since you, as a user of such programs, say if the algorithm is implemented in a program, cannot know whether you have to spend a little bit more time before finding the proof, or whether it will run forever, you don't know that. It is not a decision procedure, but if you know that a formula is valid, then you also know that eventually it will find the proof. So this is something interesting. So we can do something with mechanized mathematics. So in this video, I'll talk about the two main approaches of theorem proving, but I'll focus specifically on one, and the other one will be for the next two videos. So the first one is automated theorem proving. And in automated theorem proving, you let the machine automatically search for a proof, a proof of the validity of a formula. In contrast to that is interactive theorem proving. And interactive theorem proving allows the human user of the machine to specify how this search for a proof should go. And in that way, the human has more of a say. You do not entirely rely on the machine for finding a proof. And since the human can use his or her imagination and intuition to steer the search towards the right direction, in interactive theorem proving, you could verify more theorems. Although in automated theorem proving, for certain classes of theorems, you could automatically find proofs. So there is a nice balance between the two. But let's zoom in on automated theorem proving in this video. So I'll explain to you a little bit about what is the technique behind automated theorem proving. This is just one technique. There are also other techniques. This is a very, very well-known technique in automated theorem proving. And it's the technique called resolution. And it was also set out forth in the same paper by Davies and Putnam in 1960. And that technique was later improved by a technique called unification later on, 5 years later. Okay, so um, the Point here is, it's quite a deep topic, automated theorem proving itself. So I can impossibly go into the details in this video. So what I try to do here is to at least show you a little bit of the concepts that are involved in it. And I hope that I can bring forward some idea, or that you have a little bit of an idea of what goes on under the hood. So that whenever you want to continue studying in this direction, that you at least have heard of certain terms and know about a little bit of the basics of it. Yeah? So let's do that. By the way, I follow here a book called The Resolution Calculus by Leitch from 97. Okay, so in automated theorem proving, and in particular in resolution, we will make more specific syntactic categories. So we don't just work on the formulas of first order logic. No, we will bring more syntactic structure to these formulas so that we can automatically do something with that. And one such thing is syntactically what is an atomic formula. Atomic, atomos, means indivisible. It's the primitives of the logic. So these are the formula that do not involve the connectives or the quantifiers. So that's the formula representing falsehood, the bottom symbol. It's any relation symbol. That relation symbol was defined in some signature. Huh? Let's assume some fixed signature. And equalities between terms. So those are the atoms. And then what we say is a literal is either an atom or a negation of an atom. And we can say that if you have a literal, then the complement of that literal is the other. So whenever you have an atom that is not preceded by a negation, then the complement of that literal is the one with the negation in front of it. And whenever you have a literal which starts with the negation and then an atom, the complement is the one without the negation. And you could also call that two literals are complementary if one is the same as the other, but they differ only in a negation sign. Okay. And now, furthermore, some more syntactical conventions is a standard form of formulas. And a formula is in a standard format or a standard form whenever any of the subformulas which involve quantification, that it is not the case that then nested formulas themselves quantify over the same variable. So whenever you quantify over a variable, that variable does not occur again within a nested quantification. So this means that we don't have formulas where variables are overshadowed. This is, especially from an automatic point of view, a very useful convention. That all the bound variables have different names. Another requirement for being in standard form is that whenever you have a binary connective, let's say the one represented by the box, so the conjunction, disjunction, implication, whenever you have that particular variable is bound in one, then it does not occur at all in the other. Basically, this is a formal statement in which you say a variable never occurs bound and free at the same time within a formula. And furthermore, it also separates the naming of the variables that are appearing in quantifiers within the different subformula and binary connectors. Okay, but that's just introducing some syntactical conventions that are useful for representing formulas in a particular format whenever you want to automatically reason with them. Now, I should note that every formula can be put into standard form by renaming variables. And you must make sure that suppose you have a formula in which a variable occurs both free and bound, the bound variables can always be renamed. Eh? So let's assume from now on that all our formulas are in standard form, and then we don't have to think about that much. Okay, so recall from the previous video that a particular formula phi is satisfiable if interpretation I and state sigma phi is satisfied. So formula is satisfiable if there exists an interpretation in a state which satisfies that formula. And recall also that a particular formula phi is valid if and only if the negation of that formula is not satisfiable. Okay. And now we can say, let's introduce that a model of a formula phi is an interpretation I in a state sigma such that the formula phi is satisfied in the interpretation I in state sigma. And so then we call the interpretation I and the state sigma a model of that formula. And now we can define whether two formulas are logically equivalent. And I'll come back later why I introduce these notions, but they're important in whenever we convert formulas in one form into another form, that we preserve some properties, and those are later on needed for arguing why automatic reasoning about formulas actually implements automated theorem proving. So whenever a formula phi and psi are logically equivalent, then by that we mean that phi and psi have the same models. So that means that whenever phi it has no model, then psi also doesn't have a model. And for every model of phi, that model is also a model of psi, and vice versa. Another form of equivalence is what is called satisfiability equivalence. So the first one is logical equivalence. This is satisfiability equivalence. And satisfiability equivalence means that you have two formulas, phi and psi, and they're satisfiability equivalent whenever if one is equivalent, precisely when the other is equivalent. Okay, so these are just some notions, some preliminaries needed for introducing the rest of the story. Now, formula or term is called ground, and I also shortly said this in the previous video, but it is called ground whenever there are no free variables that occur in it. I say here no variables occur in it. No, formula can be ground even if it quantifies, but those variables then occur bound. So a formula or a term is ground if there are no free variables occurring in it. So now, suppose we want to implement a theorem prover. So what then is the theorem prover? It is an algorithm which recognizes valid formulas. So that we recognize a valid formula is also called proving that formula. Now, in the technique of resolution, to prove a formula is valid, what we do is that we work with the negation of that formula. And whenever that negation of the formula is unsatisfiable, then we know that the original phi is valid. That came namely from this claim. And so a formula phi is valid if and only if its negation is not satisfiable. So to prove the validity of the formula phi, what we want to show is that the negation of phi is not satisfiable. So we will work with the negation of phi and we will perform certain syntactic transformations on it. And then I will show you a procedure for arguing why the result of that transformation is not satisfiable. So this transformation is called putting not phi into clause form. And that transformation procedure works as follows. So first we transform not phi into a particular intermediary format, let's call it psi 1, which is logically equivalent to our original, such that psi 1 does not contain any implication connectives. And furthermore, psi 1 has no negations appearing anywhere in it, only in front of atoms. So what we get is a formula which consists only of existential universal quantification, conjunction, disjunction on the top levels, no implications, and whenever there's a negation, the negation appears only in front of the atoms. So those are the leaves, if you imagine the parse tree of the formula. Now, we can then, in the second step, eliminate the existential quantifiers from our intermediary form psi 1. And we do that by finding a satisfiability equivalent formula psi 2, which is free from existential quantifiers. And this can be done by a process called scolemization. I will not explain what it is, but you can read more about that in the literature. But the point here is that if psi 2 is not satisfiable, then because psi 1 and psi 2 are satisfiability equivalent, psi 1 is also not satisfiable. And I'll make the argument later. Complete. So then in the third step of transforming our original formula into class form, we then take the intermediary psi 2 and we put it into what is called a quantifier-free conjunctive normal form. So the quantifier-free conjunctive normal form is transforming this intermediary formula psi 2 into formula psi 3, which is of that particular form. Conjunctive normal form is the form in which on the top level of the formula you have conjuncts, and then underneath you have disjuncts, and then underneath you have literals. But in the next slide I will show you this format. And it is always possible for an arbitrary formula to put it in this form. And now the nice thing is to remove the quantifiers is we already have that psi 2 no longer has any existential quantifiers. So the universal quantifiers can simply be eliminated by removing them. And this can be done because these formulas are in standard form. So these variables are never reused in multiple places inside of the formula. So you can freely remove the quantifiers that way. Now, psi 3 is called the Clausius form of negation of phi. And so that's the final result of this transformation. Now it is the case that if the negation of phi can be shown to be unsatisfiable, so that means that it is a consequence of not phi, that the false formula, the falsehood formula, holds, which never holds in any interpretation state. Well, if that is the case, then we have established the validity of phi. And that was our original goal, because we want to do theorem proving. Namely, we want to prove the validity of phi. So, why is that? Well, if this transformed negation of phi, so that is this psi 3, if that one is unsatisfiable, so that means that it leads to falsehood. Well, if that one is unsatisfiable, well, then the logically equivalent formula psi 2 is also unsatisfiable. And if psi 2 is unsatisfiable, then psi 1 is also unsatisfiable. And since that one is again logically equivalent to not phi, then not phi must be unsatisfiable. And we have previously seen that if not phi is unsatisfiable, then phi must be valid. So that is a bit how the argument goes. Okay, so here you see the Clausius form. So this is the quantifier-free conjunctive normal form. So we have a lot of conjuncts on the top level. And then each of the conjuncts are themselves then disjunctions of literals. So in this case here, L11 is a literal, L1K1 is a literal. So we here basically have a big disjunction, finite disjunction of literals. And themselves, all these disjunctions are then put in conjuncts. So we only have two levels. So on the top level we have only conjunctions, then one level down we have disjunctions, and then on the last level we have literals. Now we call each of these disjuncts a class. And whenever a class is empty, you can write that as the bottom formula. Now clearly, if one of the clauses is bottom, since the top level is a conjunction, the whole formula is logically equivalent to bottom, which means it's unsatisfiable. So to show that a clause form is unsatisfiable, it suffices to show that a single clause is unsatisfiable, which means it's the empty clause. You can also consider this conjunction to be a set of clauses. And some people sometimes write clause as in the following format, this is a special symbol that is not part of the logic, but you can interpret this, it's called a sequent, as being the sequent is true whenever all of what is called the antecedent literals are true, then one of the what is called the succedent, one of the literals in the succedent must be true as well. So it basically is the clause in which you have the atoms A1 up to AN and the atoms B1 up to BO. And those on the left-hand side are the ones that are negated, and the ones on the right-hand side are the ones that are not negated. Okay, so the intuitive meaning is if all the atoms on the left are true, then one of the atoms on the right must be true. If that is the case, then the clause is considered to be true. So here you have an example. Let's have a formula here. And let's translate it into its negation into clause form. So first, let's put a negation in front of it, of the whole formula, and now you can use the laws that hold for transforming formulas logically equivalent, and those you know from a course of logic, that whenever you have a disjunction and you negate it, it's the same as pushing the disjunction into its disjunct and transforming it into a conjunct. So then we have a double negation on the left and we have a negation of the universal quantifier on the right. The double negation can be eliminated and the negation on the right then can be pushed in again, causing the universal quantifier to be flipped into an existential quantifier, and then we have a double negation inside as well, which can be eliminated. And we also eliminate the implication symbol here on the left by a law that's called material implication. So that means that this one is logically equivalent as the negation of what is on the left or what is on the right. And that is then the format which we expect in the first step, huh? Because no longer any implication occurs, and if there is a negation, the negation is directly on top of an atom. And here we have a relation, and here we have a relation, here we have a relation. The negations are directly on top of atoms. So then we can eliminate the existential quantification. Well, in this case, we have a single existential quantifier over here. So for that, we can introduce a new constant symbol in our signature. And this process is called scholemization. Now, it is the case that if this formula is satisfiable, then the original formula is satisfiable as well. And the reason why that is because as soon as you assign in the interpretation and in the meaning to a constant symbol, well, then there must be some value. Eh? And that's the same as if you would have quantified over it. So that's intuitively, at least, the reason why these are satisfiability equivalent. And now finally, we can transform this one into a quantifier-free conjunctive normal form. But I won't go into the details further. Okay, so let's continue then with what is the resolution algorithm. I already hinted towards it, but we want to prove the validity of our original formula phi. So we transformed the negation of phi into clause form. And now we can argue that the clause form is a set of clauses. And as soon as we have in one of those clauses, we have the bottom formula representing falsehood, then the overall clause set is is not satisfiable. So this is what the resolution algorithm mechanically performs. So it works on a clause form, so it's a set of clauses. And then the output is yes, it is unsatisfiable, or no, it is satisfiable. And since this is an algorithm, it could also not give an output and run forever. But now the point of this is that the algorithm should be sound, which means that if the algorithm produces an output, the output should be correct. So that means that if it outputs yes, the clause form is unsatisfiable, that it indeed is unsatisfiable. And if the output is no, it is satisfiable, that indeed, yes, the original clause form that you put in the algorithm is indeed satisfiable. So that is soundness of the algorithm. And now we also have something that is called refutational completeness, which is, if it is the case that the input is unsatisfiable, then eventually the algorithm will output yes. But note that this refutation completeness or refutational completeness does not say anything about the output no. Eh? And that is because this is not a decision procedure. It is not a decision procedure of satisfiability. It merely recognizes the unsatisfiable class forms. Okay. So now, given a ground class form, and by the way, I sneaked in here the word ground, but that is for a technical reason. We'll come back to that later. So given a ground class form, resolution, the algorithm is basically by repeatedly applying a number of rules. And the rules are the following. So one is called the tautology rule. So whenever you have this set of clauses, and there exists some clause in this set, which consists of complementary literals, so that means that you have some atom in the clause and the negation of that atom in the clause, you can get rid of the whole clause. And the reason why is because then the clause, since it's a disjunction, it both contains the atom, say, A, and it contains not A, but since the clause is a disjunction, the clause itself is true. And since overall the clause set it represents a conjunction, we have a true conjunct which can be eliminated. So that's the tautology rule. And then we have the one literal rule, and the one literal rule indicates that as soon as you have a clause in your clause set that consists of a single literal, then it is possible in all the other clauses of the clause set to remove those clauses which contain the literal. And as those clauses are no longer relevant, so you can eliminate them from the set. And for all the other clauses that do not contain the literal L, you may, if it contains so, remove the complementary of the literal. And that's what I mean here with the LC. It's the complementary of the single literal that you found in one clause. The third rule is the pure literal rule. It's as soon as you have a clause that subset of clauses in your set of clauses, which all share the same literal L, but the complementary literal of L does not occur anywhere, then they cannot cause this unsatisfiability. So we can get rid then of such clauses. And it's a very powerful rule for simplifying the set of clauses. And then finally, there is the splitting rule. And the splitting rule causes this algorithm to exponentially blow up, so to say. Because whenever you have a set of clauses, the splitting rule splits it up into two sets of clauses and then continues recursively this algorithm of resolution on the two sets of clauses. And so then you can imagine that we then have sort of a tree in which we, on each of the nodes, we have a set of clauses. And every time we perform the splitting rule, the tree causes a split. And we have to continue then processing in both of the branches of such a tree. Now, how does this splitting rule work? Well, given this set of clauses, we can split it in three parts if you are given a literal. There is one part, 4.1, which are precisely the clauses which do not contain L for a particular given literal L, which contain neither L nor its complement L, nor the complement of the literal L. Then the second part is the clauses that do contain L, but not its complement. And then in the third part is the clauses, so that's a set of clauses that do contain the complement of the literal L, but not the literal itself. And so now what you can continue is if you combine the set obtained from 4.1 and the set obtained from 4.2, but you have to continue by removing the literal L itself. And furthermore, in the second part where you continue, where you perform the split, is that you combine the clauses you have in 4.1 and 4.3, but where you have removed the complement of the literal L. So the result is that L is eliminated, so one atom less is whenever you then recursively apply the resolution algorithm. Okay, so that's, that, I can imagine that this is quite a heavy slide. I mean, lots of rules that I present now. Maybe you miss some intuition how it works. Well, you could dive into the material and study it for yourself. I think that's the best way to really grasp what's going on. And otherwise, I can now give you a simple example to give you a bit of an intuition of how this resolution process goes. So let's have the following example. Take P, Q, R, and S to stand for arbitrary but different ground atoms. So they all differ. And now we can take as an example the set of classes as given here. So we have P or Q. This is one class. We have R or S. That's another class. Not R or S. R or not S. Not R or not S. P or not Q. Or not P. So the first rule we could apply is the tautology rule, and you also have to apply the tautology rule before the other rules. Namely, we can see, hey, we here have a clause where in both a literal P and the literal not P occurs. And so since for if P is true, then not P is false, but the disjunction is true. But if P is false, then not P is true, so the disjunction, the overall disjunction is true. So this one does not contribute to the unsatisfiability of the overall clause form. So we can just throw it out and it doesn't change anything about the unsatisfiability. Okay, so we throw it out and now we continue with the smaller clause set. Now in this case, we then can apply the pure literal rule. And why? Because you can see here there is the literal P, but never in any of the other clauses you see its complement. So P, and the same thing by the way is true for Q, there is nothing anywhere else talking about the complement of Q. So these cannot cause an unsatisfiability. So you can throw them out of the clause set. So then we remain with R or S, not R or S, R or not S, or not R, and R or not S. And now we can perform the splitting rule. And the splitting rule, we perform it on the literal S. That means that we have to take this set and we have to split it in three parts, namely the clauses which do not talk about S at all. Well, all clauses talk about S. Then we talk about the clauses that talk, sorry, then we separate in the second part those clauses that talk about S, and then in the third part those that talk about the complementary of S, which is not S. And then, so in the first case, we look at the S occurs over here and over here. So those two are then become part of this clause set. And here we have the clauses that are or not S, not R or not S. And those talk about the complementary of S, namely not S. So these two become part of the second clause set. So we basically cause a split in the algorithm and we have to recurse on both of these clause sets. But moreover, before we continue, we can get rid of S. So we have eliminated here an atom. Which causes the result to become smaller, eh? And then this recursive process each time it becomes smaller, so that's why the algorithm can proceed. And what we can now see is, okay, we have in this case we have R in one clause and not R in another clause. So then we can apply the one literal rule, namely with the literal R, because what does the one literal rule say? The one literal rule say if you have a class that consists of a single literal L, then you can remove all classes which contain that literal and delete the complementary of that literal from the other classes. Well, we have here R, it's a single literal in a clause, so we can now delete it and every other class which contains R, but there is no other class which contains R. Moreover, in this clause, we have not R, which is the complementary of it. So we can remove this from the clause, but then we get an empty clause, which is represented by the bottom. And the same thing applies with the clause set over here. So that means we now have two clause sets, namely a clause set consisting of the clause consisting of false, and this clause set is unsatisfiable. So because these clause sets are unsatisfiable, and I'm not arguing why this algorithm is sound, but because these are unsatisfiable, our original set of clauses is itself also unsatisfiable. So if this original set of clauses was obtained from a formula by putting that formula in a negation and then performing these transformation steps, thereby obtaining this set of clauses. We know that then the outcome here is, hey, it's unsatisfiable, so the original one must be unsatisfiable. So the original formula which we negated then was valid, and this completes the proof. Okay, maybe a bit technical, but I hope it shows you a little bit how this process goes. So, can we go back to our original formula that we had performed, where we had performed the transformation to put it in clause form and perform resolution on that set of clauses? Well, the answer is no, because we cannot yet apply the resolution rules because these clauses are not yet ground. Only here we have a ground clause because there we have constant symbols, but the rest have free variable occurrences. And those free variable occurrences cannot yet you cannot yet proceed with the resolution algorithm if you still have these non-ground clauses. So to proceed in that way, this is quite the crux of the algorithm. We have to instantiate them because you can understand these clauses which are not ground to be universally quantified. They hold for all x and y's. So if we instantiate them, then let's do that. We can see, hey, what would be a clever choice of instantiation? And you could try out different instantiations, but what would be a clever choice of instantiation is we recognize here we have a literal. And what if we have somewhere else a negation of that literal? And well, that could be, for instance, over here. If y would be c and x would be c, then we here have the negation of this literal over here, and then we can proceed with the resolution algorithm. So that is what you can recognize. You can recognize that you have literals, one that are ground and the other that are not ground. But if you would overlap them, then you could proceed with a set of ground clauses. So let's do that. So instantiate x with c and y with c, and then we obtain the following. Oh, I've made a mistake here. This should be c and this should be c. Okay. And then whenever we now have this clause set, we can then, because everything here is now ground, perform the resolution algorithm. So that means we can simplify the clauses. So here we say, okay, we have here a not c smaller than c or not c smaller than c. These are the same literals, so we can remove the duplicate literals from the clause. So then we get this one. So here you now see, oh, we have not c smaller than c and we have c smaller than c. You should consider that this is in conjunction because the clause set represents a conjunction. So this is likely not to be, well, not likely, this is not satisfiable. And so we can obtain that by applying the one literal rule with the literal not c smaller than c. So we use this as a literal. The complementary literal is over here. So what we do is the literal we want to remove, apply the one literal rule with here, the not c is all clauses which also contain not c smaller than c can be removed. So this clause can be removed. This clause can be removed. And then from this clause we can remove the complementary of our chosen literal. Well, the complementary is c smaller than c. So if in this clause we remove c smaller than c, we obtain then the empty clause, and that then represents that we have an unsatisfiable set of clauses. Well, you could then also argue, well, could we have not applied this one literal rule with a different literal, namely the literal over here? Yes, that could be possible. In that case, you remove all the clauses in which this literal occur. Well, there are no clauses in which c smaller than c occur. So we then have this clause over here and this clause over here. And then we have to delete from these remaining clauses the complementary literal. So in this case, we delete not c smaller than c and we obtain the empty clause. And in this case, we delete this not c smaller than c and we obtain this x not equal to y, which by the way was a mistake. This should all be c over here. C is not equal to c. And then the final clause set can then be simplified by using the pure literal rule, because this literal over here does not occur anywhere else, so you can eliminate it. And then we also end up with a set consisting of an empty clause, which then represents that this clause form is unsatisfiable. And by the soundness of the algorithm, if this one is unsatisfiable, then our original one is unsatisfiable. And if, since this one was obtained from the negation of our original formula, this then is a proof that our original formula, one of the first slides, was indeed valid. Okay, so that is resolution. And what you saw here is, hey, we made a choice on how to instantiate our formulas. Huh? We instantiated x with x and y both with c. But how can we make those choices well-informed? Well, and that is to make such well-informed instantiation choices. There is this process called unification. And in unification, you basically take two literals, and then you want one literal to be the complementary of another literal, but there are variables in maybe both of them. And you want to make sure that they overlap in the proper way after an instantiation. And now you seek a special such an instantiation that you can perform the resolution algorithm. That's the purpose of unification. The point is that whenever you have two non-ground literals, but you can recognize from their structure that one is the negation of another, but there are still some variables occurring within it, then does there exist an instantiation which causes them to overlap, to cause them to become ground, and then that you can then perform a resolution algorithm. Well, unification itself is quite an advanced topic. It has a very special property. Yeah? Unification can be defined in general for first-order logic. And it's quite nice that in first-order logic, this unification problem, which I'm not going to define here, but you can look it up yourself in the literature, is decidable. It's quite a nice result. But I'll just now show you an example so that you get an intuitive idea of what unification is about. So consider, for example, the following set of clauses, and the clauses are single literals. So this is a clause consisting of a single literal, and this is a clause consisting of a single literal. Now we could resolve this set of clauses if it turns out that this literal is the same as that literal, that they eventually boil down to the same ground clause. But to do so, we want to unify, because we here have variables and we here have variables, but what if we can match them up, make sure that they coincide. So for instance, if you would instantiate here x to become ga, then you can already see, hey, then they match up over there, so that's a good first step. So we say, okay, well, let's instantiate x to be g of a. Then what we get is we replace the x and the x over here with ga, and then we get the following clause set. And already you see, well, they start to become a little bit more of a similar shape. But we still have to instantiate more variables. Because here we have a z in the second place of p, but here in the second place of p we have f of g of a b. So if we now want to make sure that these align properly, that they unify properly, what we could then say is, well, let's now instantiate z. Oh no, we don't instantiate z. Here apparently the choice is the third place of p is a u here, while the third place of the p is here hz. So if we would take u to become hz, then you can see that the we are getting closer and closer and closer to the same literal. And now the step I said about the z to become the fga, well, then you get something like this. So we replace z by fga, but now we also have to replace all other occurrences of z, so the thing explodes a bit. But if you squeeze your eyes, then you can see that the literal over here and the literal over here are complementary. And that is, as soon as you have a literal, single literal, and you have a complementary single literal, this one can be then instantiated, and then we can apply the resolution algorithm to resolve. Okay, this, just trying to give you a little bit of the feeling of what is going on here. It's quite a technical and deep topic itself, so I can't go into all the details in this video. But I hope at least you have gotten a glimpse of what this automated theorem proving is about. Okay, thank you for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon.